there are certain things that we need to define in the context of outreach. And these things are, when they happen, they are innocent mistakes. Okay. Let me lay out the case. And I want those that are not in the prophetic team to answer me. I need a volunteer. Anybody that is not in the prophetic team, a volunteer. I need 3 volunteers. Thank you, Madam Binta. Anybody else? All right. I want you guys to, my volunteers, to answer this question. You step into a meeting, an outreach meeting. Maybe, for instance, the kind of one that we're going to have in Ghana. Madam Binta, since you are in Ghana, maybe you can help us out first. Anyway, you're number one. And in this outreach activity, you have widows that are both Christian and Muslim. You have widows that are both Christian and Muslim. And now you want to raise praise and worship. And you didn't know that there were widows that were Muslim there. And all of a sudden you start dealing with frowns. They are frowning on their face, they are frowning because they are Muslim. They don't believe in what you believe. How do we handle that? How would you handle that, Madam Binta? I just want us to learn. There's no right or wrong answer. So just give us your opinion. From Madam Binta, we'll go to Eberi. From Eberi, we'll go to Madam Bola.
Okay. Okay, by God's grace, when we get there, we have to explain who we are and where we're coming from. You know, so if they know that we're Christians and we're coming from a faith-based NGO ministry, like the Tribe of Marketplace Ministers, we have to explain that we're coming from there and that we're coming to show them the love and compassion of Jesus Christ, because that's the truth, that's the purpose. Just like you always say, if a purpose of a thing is not known, there will be abuses inevitable. So we have to tell them that it's because of Jesus Christ we're there. And so we want to praise him. We want to acknowledge his presence, because though we know that we have people of other religion, but we just came to preach the message or the gospel from Jesus Christ. Yeah, so I believe that's just what I'm going to tell them.
All right, Madam Iberi, thank you, Madam Binta.
Thank you, sir.
Madam Iberi,
good evening. Okay, so I believe that the reason they are frowning is because they were not told who we were and what we were there for. So it's important that we introduce ourselves, kind of share the word of God with them before we start. So for them to still sit there till the point of sharing the food, it means that they are game on it, and I don't think they will frown at it. But even if they frown, we'll kind of see how we can settle the because before we go, first of all, we'd have prayed and asked that God touches their heart. But if we still see that they are frowning, we'll just ask the Holy Spirit to give us the right word to speak to them that will calm the situation. I'm sure that there are things that you speak to them that, you know, will hit their heart, that they will kind of, God will help and Holy Spirit will help turn that heart of stone to heart of flesh, in a way that they'll be able to be, you know, receptive of our word and what we came there to do.
Thank you. Madam Bola.
Okay, sir. So like all as I've said, the first thing is you have to introduce yourself first. When you are anywhere, let them know where you are coming from and who you are. So even after doing that, and we are now doing praise and worship and they are frowning at it, after that, we could make them understand that we are not here to preach religion, but just to show the goodwill of God. And from the teachings that will be coming out, even if they are Muslims, there are so many Muslims that have come across like that. When they now hear the word, they have this soft heart and be like, so it's not like they're imposing religion on us. It's not about religion. I'm just coming to show you the light. And through that, many people can give their life to Jesus.
Thank you, Madam Bola. You can put your hands down. I want a quick vote. A quick vote. In the last 'Kay. It came to my attention the last outreach activity we had in Abuja, where we had Muslim widows, Christian widows. One of our very own made an announcement. And said that they should feel free to join in anyways, because we all serve the same God. We all serve the same God. If you believe we all serve the same God. If you believe we all serve the same God, Christians and Muslims, can I see your hand? Maybe you guys didn't hear the question. Maybe Madam Binta has given you people expo. If you believe Christians and Muslims serve the same God, can I see your hand, please? Okay. If you don't believe we all serve the same God, can I see your hand? Wow. I'm going to skip Madam Binta, and I want one of the other people that are their hands are raised to give me their reason why we don't serve the same God.
Okay, sir. So for me, I would say we don't serve the same God, because for them, up till now, they don't believe that Jesus is the Son of God. And some even say, why do we call Jesus God? That is not God, that is just a servant of God. So for people that does not believe that Jesus is God, we cannot say we are serving the same God. But they don't believe in him as a God. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam B. Titi. Titi, you yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so yes, they don't believe in Jesus, but I know a couple of Muslims who actually believe in God, and I've actually heard what they understand, right? But for me, I raised up my hands because generally now I don't know who actually believes in God, because there's some Christians who don't believe in God. They believe in New Age and all the other things. So there are people who actually call God, but they don't believe in God too. So test the spirit. Plus, we're supposed to, if we're worshiping or serving God, is in spirit and in truth. And Jesus Christ is truth, the way, the truth, and the life. So his truth. So if Jesus Christ is not in the equation, then I don't think they completely know what it means to serve God or to even believe in God.
Thank you, Titi. Madam Berry, let's make it a short answer so that we can move fast.
Okay, so the Bible says that no one comes to me except through my son, Jesus Christ, and they don't believe in Jesus. They don't go through Jesus. So I don't even understand what they're doing. They claim, yes, he's the same God, but as long as you're neglecting his son, like he says, you cannot attend to me, you cannot get to me except you come through my son, then I'm not sure we're on the same page in that light.
Okay. Susan, you want to say something? Thank you, Ebere. Susan, if you want to say something, you can go ahead and do that. She said she's on the road. Okay, if you're speaking, I can't hear you. You're speaking, Susan. I'm going to have to keep you because I can't hear you. All right. You all have answered well. And from the feedback I received, it's just a well wish. The person meant well. There was no harm intended. But it is my duty as a leader to make sure we are all on the same page, all on the same page, because we would probably have future events where these kinds of things happen, and it is our responsibility to ensure that everybody understands the goal of outreach. The answer is that we are not all serving the same God. The defining mark is the Son of God, Christ Jesus. If you don't pray through Jesus Christ, it's not possible that we serve the same God. Because like Eberi said, nobody comes to the Father except through him. And the Muslims believe that he was a prophet. Christians believe that he is the Son of God. He is God himself. That differentiating mark, even though I share the same sentiments that they are praying to God or they are trying to pray to God, the differentiating mark is the fact that Christians pray through Jesus Christ. He is the only way to the Father, the only way. He's not one of the many ways. He is the only way. Now, in an outreach activity or event where we have people that are Christians and Muslims in that place, we have to first of all make our stance known. The first thing is that the work needs to be done and well done, that before we even come out, people know that this is a Christian organization. And the truth is that the goal of outreach is the salvation of souls. That's the honest truth. The purpose of outreach, the true goal of it, is not just to be kind to your brother or to your sister. The true goal of it is the salvation. Listen, that is the... Okay. We have to teach our people on how to say our convictions without rubbing it on people's faces. But still, they get the point. They get the point. We are for Christ. The goal of true outreach is the salvation of souls into God's kingdom. But there is a way you do it whereby, in that kind of setting, Christ is still glorified and it is not rubbed into people's faces. But let me share something very important that God put in my spirit. And before I do, I want to thank the Ghanaian team for all of their efforts and everything they've done so far. to put together everything needed for the outreach activity in Accra. You guys make the burden lighter on leadership. So thank you. We bless you. Thank you, guys. Look at the scripture. Set your attention on from verse 41. In this story, let me tell you what happened. Jesus was surrounded by the chief priest. The story started from Matthew 21. It spilled into Matthew 22. Before his final days, after he triumphantly entered Jerusalem and turned the table of the money changers, certain conversations happened. Jesus Christ, God in the flesh, was questioned by a group of people. He was approached. He was surrounded by the chief priest. He was surrounded by the elders. He was surrounded by the Pharisees. He was surrounded by the Herodians. He was surrounded by the Sadducees. And he was surrounded by a lawyer. There are six people that surrounded Jesus Christ. And they began to throw questions at him. They wanted to ensnare him. It was a very tactical approach. They knew what they were doing. And these guys all began to ask him puzzling questions one by one. If we had the time, we would have gone to Matthew 21 and started pulling it from there, but I don't have the time to show you all of that. I'm just going to summarize the story so we can pick it up from here. The first people that asked him a question were the chief priest. And the chief priests in the nation of Israel represent the authority of the Jewish religion. The authority. The Jewish religion had become an authority. They had become, you know, gone into rites and rituals, and they had taken off God out of the whole thing. It had become religiosity, not spirituality. So each time you see the chief priest in scriptures, they represent the authority of the Jewish religion. They were the first to question Jesus. And then we see the elders. The elders represented the authority of the Jewish people, while the chief priests represent the authority of the Jewish religion. The elders represented the authority of the Jewish people. The elders of the people, like chiefs. And these two people, they questioned Jesus about his own authority. Imagine questioning God about his authority. They questioned him about his authority. And then, when they were done, the Pharisees stepped in, the fundamentalists, the Herodians, those who were zealous in politics, and they began to ask him about politics as if he was a politician. The Pharisees and the Herodians, they asked him, is it lawful to give tribute to Caesar? I wish I had time to explain that question. They asked him that question. Is it lawful to give tribute to Caesar? And the way Jesus answered was so wise. He asked them for a coin. And he told them, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and give to God what belongs to God. But that wasn't the end of it. You would think they would have left him because of the wisdom he displayed. Then the Sadducees came to question him. You should study this chapter 21 and 22. When they came, they began to question him. They said that a woman existed, and she got married to seven brothers. She married the first brother. The guy died. He had no kids. And the law of Moses says that the brother should raise seed. To raise seed. And these guys asked these questions because they did not believe in resurrection. The Sadducees don't believe in resurrection and afterlife. So they were trying to ensnare Jesus with these questions. And Jesus told them, have you not read? And do you not know that when they die, they are like the angels? They are neither given in marriage or give themselves in marriage. And they kept quiet. And you would think it would end there. It did not end there. They now sent a lawyer, a self-approved lawyer. The lawyer asked him a question about the law. The lawyer asked, what is the greatest commandment in the law? All these questions. And of course, you know how Jesus answered. Jesus answered, love the Lord your God and love people. Very simple. That all the law and the prophets are summarized in those two things. Then the questions kind of stopped. And when Jesus answered all questions wisely, he then asked them a question about the Christ. And this is the question of questions. Guys, can I hear you people say this after me? This is the question of questions. Say that. It is the question of questions. And that's where he picked it up from verse 41. It says, while the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, saying, what do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he? That's the question of questions. You see, these interesting people, they had questions about religion. They had questions about politics, about belief, you know, asking him, the Sadducees asking, whose wife would the woman be since she married all seven brothers? They had all those kind of questions. They had questions about the law, but they knew nothing about the Christ. They had no clue about the Christ. Unknown to them, the Christ is the center. The center of everything. He was the center of religion, the center of politics, the center of their belief system, the center of the law. And the irony was that they knew nothing about the Christ. But still, they were the ones questioning the Christ. This is the question of questions. What do you think about the Christ? This question will shape your convictions, my friend, especially in outreach ministry. What do you think about the Christ? Is he one of the many prophets that came, that the Muslims believe, you know, is just one of the prophets? Is he a servant? Is he Lord of all and Master of all? What do you think about the Christ? Many years ago, you know, I had to answer this question for myself. And I want to challenge you. If you've not answered this question for yourself, oh, it may be high time you do. What do you think about the Christ? I had to face the question that, is it true that God came down in the flesh, put on mortal flesh, became like man and died for us and died for me? It's like a man becoming an ant. And to be honest with you, because I was born into Christianity and I saw the religiosity, just like the Pharisees, the elders, that had turned everything to a mundane religion. I slipped into the religiosity of it all. I slipped into it until the day that I received the baptism of the Holy Ghost a second time. You know, the first time was when I was a kid. I was young. My mother's school. I became born again at the age of 10, 11, thereabouts. And the man that led me to Christ, I can't forget that man, Mr. Adeniji. Bless him wherever he is. A teacher in my mother's school. It was him and another woman that did the Holy Ghost baptism. And you know, because you're a young boy, you know, so you speak in tongues and you know, you. But when you begin to grow up and you begin to see your friends have girlfriend and all of these things, and you don't want to miss out on the fun of life, you slip into religiosity. God becomes the person you attend to on Sundays. And on Monday through Saturday, you pick up your life and you do your thing. Until that day, many, many years ago, serving my first spiritual mentor, and he said, you need a fresh baptism of the Holy Ghost. Listen, as that man began that baptism, it was a few of us in that hall that day. Before he even came to me, I burst out in tongues. It was uncontrollable. That I don't know where it came from. And I burst out in tongues and I was crying tears. Something real, something supernatural had engulfed my essence. I now knew that the Christ was not someone I read about in a book. He has a spirit, It is called the Spirit of Jesus Christ. And that spirit came on me that day. I belched out and I could not stop speaking in tongues for 30 minutes. What do you think about the Christ? I couldn't stop it. It's like the thing was waiting to come out of me. It was waiting like a force to flow out of me. Before he even put his hand on my head, I just burst out in tongues. Everybody had stopped speaking. I was still going. It was as if I had to finish pulling out the rope from the inside of me. I now knew that there are two different economies in this world. Oh my God. You can know about the Christ like you read a novel. But you can experience the Christ. In this passage, Jesus tells them the question of questions after they had laden him with all kinds of questions. They asked all kinds of silly questions. And the irony of it all, they knew nothing. Nothing about the Christ. Who happens to be the center of their livelihood. Because the chief priests, the elders, the scribes, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Herodians, all of them prized themselves in their religion. And they were so blinded, they could not see that the Christ was the real person they were worshipping. They had turned the whole thing to a mundane religion. What do you think about the Christ? Listen, my friends, the irony here is that the chief priests and the elders and the Pharisees and the Herodians and all of them that asked him questions and that silly lawyer, they never for once asked themselves that question. They never for once. Up until they killed him, they thought they were doing God a service, a favor. Meanwhile, that's the person they were trying to worship. Isn't that sad? And every day, many Christians walk the streets of Accra, Ghana, the streets of Nairobi, Kenya, and Lagos, Nigeria. They've never for once asked themselves, what do I think about the Christ? They don't ask. If it's to dance in church, they will show up and dance. but they have never asked themselves the question. If Christ is the center of your life, oh my God, it is the center of all things. All things. The Bible says by him all things were made, and through him all things consist. He is the breath you breathe. What do you think about the Christ? And I love how verse 42, Jesus said, whose son is he? Whose son is he? You know, these elders and Pharisees and chief priests, they are very funny people. They seem to have all the answers by the book. Perhaps the Torah had become like a novel to them. They had all the answers, but they had never experienced the Christ. That day that I received that fresh baptism of the Holy Ghost, that's when I knew that there is a different economy people can live their life by. A different economy. The appetite for sin began to dry up. I knew something special had happened inside of me. I couldn't just go by the bar anymore and just be with my friends and just watch them drink. No, I could not. Something had begun to brew on the inside of me. That is the greatest miracle, my friends. When a person, like an unbeliever or a Muslim, receives the Christ in their heart, and there is a regeneration. It's like a feeling of brand new love. Something begins to brew in their heart. It is the greatest miracle. Don't wait till you see lame hands or lame feet grow out, or the deaf speak, or the deaf hear and the dumb speak. No. It's when you by yourself, you know that something special has happened. Something special has happened. Oh, you see now, my heart is open. My heart is open. I feel his presence. He has begun to saturate the atmosphere. This is the greatest miracle. What do you think about the Christ? Every day we have Christians walking the streets of the earth. They've never for once asked themselves that question, especially if you were born into a Christian family. Have you asked yourself for once, what do I think about the Christ? Whose son is he? Is he truly the Son of God? What are my convictions about the Christ? If we have no convictions about the Christ, my friends, then we will become people that will just think that we can tell everybody, Muslims and Christians included, that we all serve the same God. Whose son is he? They said to him, he is the son of David. You can see that the answers were by the book. They knew the answers. He is the son of David. The son of David. And Jesus asked them a question. If he is the son of David, how then does David in the spirit call him Lord? You don't know why he said that statement. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord said to my Lord. See, David, that man was... he was piping. When you see visions of God, there are things that you can't even explain. The Lord said to my Lord. David called him Lord. So how is it the son of David? We can't go on doing certain activities. We need a realization of who the Christ is. This is the different maker, the different maker in the life of everybody. I'm telling you the truth. You want to experience realities in the economies of God. It is hinged on your knowing the Christ, what you think about the Christ. If David then calls him Lord, how is he his son? Jesus wanted to just watch their mind, their intelligence, since they claim to be so intelligent. They had asked him all kinds of questions. Answer this one now. The Bible says no one was able to answer him a word. Nor from that day on did anyone dare question him anymore. My friends, you have to come to that point when you ask yourself this question. What do you think about the Christ? Is he Lord of your life? Is he Lord of your finances? Is he Lord of your body? Is he Lord of your soul? Because what you think about the Christ determines his government over your life. It determines it. Everybody must answer that question for themselves. And this is the question of questions. Nobody can answer it for you. It is the question of questions. What do you think about the Christ? One day I got into an Uber, and just to make small talk, I just asked the guy, what do you think about the Christ? And he went on the rampage. The simplest tool, question of evangelism. And then you begin to see that people have not experienced who they claim they worship. Jesus said, we know who we worship. We know what we worship. You must answer that question for yourself. You have to. Because it is from that question that there is an outflow of outreach. The realization of who the Christ is why we do what we do, why we spend our lives and our livelihood on him. A knowledge. Until you begin to understand that everything in the realms of God exists around the Christ. It is the center, the epicenter of the kingdom of God. You won't know what to do with yourself sometimes. And you will come to that point when you will wonder why you are doing what you are doing. What is behind all the activity? We can't keep on doing activity forever, my friends. No, we can't. Otherwise, we will soon look like the chief priests, the elders, the Pharisees, the Herodians. Those that are zealous in politics and the Sadducees. Worst of it all, I've seen those that have become self-approved lawyers. All because of scriptures. But nobody has asked themselves, what do I think about the Christ? My friends, it is from when you ask that question that the ministry of encounters begins to break open in your life. Because you've asked a legitimate question. And unlike how the Pharisees and elders were silenced, God will now begin to give you encounters to know who the Christ really is. When I had an encounter with Jesus Christ, oh my God, the glory that was radiating from him, it first of all cleansed everything I thought about the Christ. I now had a first-hand experience. That's why you can hear the conviction in my voice. I've seen him. You need that for your outreach ministry. What do you think about the Christ? What do you think about the Christ? What do you think about the Christ? When the Bible says the government shall be upon his shoulders, you don't know that he is judge, he is lawgiver. He's the same person that is president. That's the government being upon his shoulder. What do you think about the Christ? What you think becomes the source of your conviction as you do outreach. Because you can't bear to see somebody else burn in the furnace of hellfire. You want them to taste of the goodness of the Christ. I'm going to stop here. Our time has gone. It's time for Marketplace Ministers Fellowship. But as I stop here today, I ask everybody on this call, in your quiet time, ask yourself that question. What do I think about the Christ? What do I think about the Christ? Let us pray. Father, I ask that as they ask this question, let the ministry of encounters break out in their lives. Let it break out in their lives, oh God. A realization. We don't want to be like the elders, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the lawyer, the Herodians, the zealots, people that just do things. And they have no experience, no encounter with the Christ or with the Spirit of Jesus Christ. I ask, oh God, that our outreach ministry will bring about a prophet for the Christ, a prophet of souls into his kingdom. Thank you, Father, for answered prayers. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.